So spinal segments and spinal nerves, some of them are a little more complicated than others. So in general, this diagram kind of represents what we talked about in the previous segment, where you have a spinal segment, one spinal nerve, and it comes out and distributes. This is a diagram of its distribution on your body surface, okay? And so what you can see from this is that your spinal segments overlap, and that's a good thing. So most of them are pretty simple. These would represent things in your thorax. For example, your what we call your intercostal nerves. They come out, they run around the edge of the rib, and then, you know, give off little branches to your sides and then to your anterior chest. There are, though, areas of the body where the spinal nerves exit. They come together to form this great big net, and then they, but then again, once they hit the surface, they distribute evenly, just like the simple ones. So some of them are simple, like your intercostal nerves, and some are more complex, and they form plexuses. And we'll talk about the plexuses in a separate lecture called spinal peripheral nerves too. So with regard to your spinal nerves, you have 31 pairs, and these include 8 cervical, 12 thoracic, 5 lumbar, 5 sacral, and 1 coccygeal. So those you have 31 pairs of spinal nerves, you have 31 spinal segments. And you'd say, well, Dr. Sullivan, I only have 7 cervical vertebrae. How can I have 8 cervical nerves? So you have 31 pairs of spinal nerves, 31 spinal segments, 8 cervical, 12 thoracic, 5 lumbar, 5 sacral, and 1 coccygeal. Where this starts to not make it a little, where this starts to get maybe a little confusing is that you have 7 cervical vertebrae, but 8 cervical nerves. This is because C1 exits over the top of the first cervical vertebra, right underneath the skull base and right over the C1 vertebra. So C1 through C8 exit over the vertebral body. T1 all the way down through S are going to exit under the vertebral body. Okay, so T1 exits below the T1 vertebra. Okay, so all the way from C1 over till we get to C8, which exits under C7, and then T1 over under T1 all the way down to the sacrals. So I hope that makes sense. The spinal cord ends at approximately L1 to L2, because as we discussed earlier, when you're an infant, your spinal cord is about the same length as your vertebral column, but as you grow, the cord grows much more slowly than the vertebra. And so the result is that the nerves still exit, make their appropriate exits, which results in this cauda equina, this big horsetail bundle of spinal nerves. The significance of this is when you, if you're sick enough, hopefully you never are, to need a lumbar puncture, this makes it really convenient. So what I want you to do is put your fingers on your iliac crest. Move your thumbs then straight back, and you're at about L4. So if you enter the spinal column or the vertebral column at around L4, you notice that the needle's going to go in and there's no spinal cord to hit. This is really good because you can puncture and draw cerebrospinal fluid from within the dura at this point. And the needle, because of the pressure, have you ever tried to put a fork in and just poke a spaghetti noodle in the water? It doesn't work very well. It just squishes out of the way. That's basically what happens with the cauda equina when you push in a needle to do a spinal tap. The nerves move out of the way. You're able to get a sample of the cerebral spinal fluid, and then you don't add insult to injury by poking a hole in the actual spinal cord itself. In the next segment, we'll talk in more detail about some of these spinal nerves.